Hi, and welcome back to Ivy English. I'm Karen.
And I'm Chris Gorski.
Today is April 25th, and can we do this broadcast later?
No. We must do this now. In fact, I'll carry this ship if I have to.
I just am not in the mood.
Well, sometimes you gotta buckle down. You gotta pull up your pants and get to work.
Pull up your pants. It's not that bad. Okay, our title is Laziness and How to Overcome It.
Yeah. When I received this article and I was thinking about what we would do today, I genuinely said to myself, we have to be the worst possible people to talk about this topic.
Speak for yourself, John.
This is this was a surprise to me as we discussed this. So my position is I have very little trouble motivating. I'm probably the worst person to talk to about how to motivate because I invest a lot of stock in the famous Nike quote, just do it.
Yeah.
Just do it, man. Stop being a baby. Just go to work. Go do it. Stop complaining. And that's who I am.
So listeners, please get the motivation that you can from Chris because I'm sure there are a lot of people you know who are not like this. When you see somebody else who is so hyped up and so on top of everything right away, it's an inspiration because the people around us really, really affect our own attitudes and behavior.
Yeah. Now, interestingly, you told me that you don't necessarily have this position. Given all that you've accomplished, it's hard to do when you're a lazy, unmotivated person. So in all honesty, it struck me as surprising when you said, no, you're actually not like you throw down and get to work.
Well, actually, that we discussed it further and we found it's a matter of prioritizing.
Right.
Because I have a lot of daily habits that I stick to almost every single day, unless there's some, you know, urgent thing I have to get out of the house for. But even like for our recording, I have to get out early in the morning. I read some ancient Chinese literature every morning right now. I'm trying to work my way through the Spring and Autumn Annals and the Zuo Commentary. Now, this is some of the most difficult material I have tackled in Chinese, but I decided it's on my bucket list. I want to try to get through this work before I leave this world. I read it pretty much every single day, first thing before I have breakfast. And I have gotten through a lot of classical Chinese literature this way. So in that way, I'm not lazy about that. I do that. After that, I generally exercise. When I exercise, I listen to French. So I have a whole bunch of things I do pretty much every day. If I don't get it done in the morning, I try to get it done later. And so for my reading, I didn't have time before I left. I read it on the bus this morning. So I find a way to do it. So in fact, there are ways that there are things I really stick to. But what happens is I have my list of priorities, and once I've gotten through my whole list, there may be other important things that I didn't get to. That's my problem, is priorities.
How flexible are you if a sudden problem arises? Are you more rigid? So my wife has this problem. She's a little bit too rigid with her schedule, and if a problem arises, she can't fit it in, whereas my schedule is like Bruce Lee, be like water. It will take whatever form it needs to, but that's just maybe I'm a little unique in my ability just to tackle problems as they go.
Well, actually, when an article was due at midnight that night or the next day, I would stay up late and get up early and not do the other things. I would have to finish this first because the deadline was approaching in a few hours. So you have to make changes. You have to be flexible when you have a really tight deadline. So I would do that. But then I would worry about losing my original good habits, so I jump right back into them.
Right. Interesting.
Yeah. So people manage it differently. We all have to prioritize. And according to your priorities, you will get some things done and maybe not get to other things. So again, our title is Laziness and How to Overcome It. So in my case, I don't think it's laziness. I think it's just I don't get to everything because I'm trying to do a bunch of other stuff. And laziness also doesn't make sense to me. If I'm feeling lazy, it's because I'm tired. I've been working too hard.
Yeah, burnout. I will say that I'm more in danger of burnout than I am any of the other things we will talk about. That's not to say if you do suffer from this that I look down on you. I actually have some good friends that they're lazy. Man, they're so lazy. But when they talk to me about motivation, honestly, after a while, after they stopped listening, after they solicited my advice multiple times on the topic and then proceeded to do nothing, I just make fun of them. They're my friends, so it's different. I just started abusing them.
All right. Now, we've been throwing around some terms like priorities and laziness without really defining them. Now, it doesn't talk so much about priorities here, but it definitely talks about laziness and another word that people sometimes confuse with it, namely procrastination. So let's jump into our article and find out the differences between these different problems people have in dealing with their work. So our title, Laziness and How to Overcome It. Everyone finds it hard to get work done every now and then. Even though we all struggle with this, we generally consider a lack of work negative. We use words such as lazy, procrastinating, and idle to describe those who fail to get work done. While these terms are similar, they have slightly different meanings.
Laziness may be used when someone has a task to perform but isn't completing it because they don't want to use up a lot of their energy. Being lazy doesn't mean not doing something at all. You can do a job in a lazy way if you are not putting in the effort required to do it well. Of course, you can also be lazy by avoiding the task altogether and instead spending your time watching TV or scrolling on your phone.
Being lazy might sound like procrastinating, but there is a distinction. When you avoid a job out of laziness, you do so to dodge work. Procrastination usually indicates postponing an unpleasant task by doing other work. In this case, you're still getting stuff done, just not what you should be doing at that moment. If you don't want to write an essay for history class, you may choose to study for a chemistry exam, even though the deadline for the paper is earlier than the date of the test. This is more about poor time management than being lazy.
Then there is being idle. Idle means not doing anything, but this isn't always laziness. Being idle may mean you have done your tasks and are free to do nothing. In fact, idleness can be good. The drive to be productive all the time isn't good for us and can leave us burned out. Instead, it is healthy to enjoy moments of idleness when we can give our bodies and brains a rest.
And in my experience, your body and brain will let you know when you have to be idle for a while.
You know, even when I face burnout, and I do face burnout because I am not a person that can do nothing very well. I can't be idle.
That's amazing.
I am also a person that will just put my head down and grind it out. I'm very good at the grind. I know this is to probably my long-term negative health. Like, this is going to affect me someday.
But you get stuff done.
I will carry it on my back. I'm that kind of person.
I wasn't going to say stuff, but it's for the radio.
I'm going to get it done. I will make it happen.
That's really interesting. It's different people have different approaches. Let's go back to the beginning. Everyone finds it hard to get work done every now and then. And Chris takes issue with this. He just sits down and does it. Now, for me, it's hard for me to sit down and do something, especially at the beginning of a project when I'm not really clear on how I'm going to do it. If I haven't got a structure in mind, I don't have a direction in mind, I just have to sit down and do it. That's hard. Beginnings are hard.
I'm curious how a person that has a calmer mind actually thinks during their day. I wish I could read their thoughts.
Wow.
Because my thoughts, I'm always thinking of my next step. I'm not a person that has idle, empty space. I have a friend that's very interested in meditation and being calm. And she has mentioned to me that it may be beneficial to me, but my mind is just not tuned that way. It is, what's the next step?
But I think that's another thing you can learn from listening to Chris talk about the way he works. He's always thinking of his next step. That's one way to keep yourself moving. A lot of people finish this and their mind is blank. No, while you're doing this, kind of get your brain ready for what you're going to do next. If you just give your brain a message that I need to do this next, it will slowly prepare you for that and it will be a less hard transition. Okay? Next sentence, even though we all struggle with this, we generally consider a lack of work negative. Now that I do identify with it because I am workaholic. So in some ways I'm kind of similar to you, and that is, what do you do on a holiday, on a day off? I work. I guess that's a definition of a workaholic. But from the other side, work is what makes me so happy. I love work. It makes me happy. So, of course, I'm going to sit down and work. And once I kind of indulge myself, I think, oh, I'm going to take the day off. My brain will start getting the habit of, oh, it's a holiday today. Well, it's a special occasion. Let's take another day off. I don't want my brain to do that.
You know, interestingly, yeah, on days off, okay, here we go. We have a little extra free time. I'm going to hit the gym for 2 hours today.
There you go.
Not going for an hour. Yeah, I'm like you, where I'm definitely a workaholic. And I imagine people must be listening to me right now thinking this sounds like a nightmare. But
no.
It makes me happy. And I
yes.
really enjoy my teaching. I really enjoy being in the classroom. I enjoy improving my work. And so I suppose it's not all bad, but I think my wife wants me to slow down.
Our next sentence, we use words such as lazy, procrastinating, and idle to describe those who fail to get work done.
So procrastinating is probably the most interesting word here. I think lazy is really clear. Idle means you're not doing anything, but it's different than lazy, like just watching TV. Idle means you do nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Procrastinating is you're putting work off. You're not getting it done. You're waiting and waiting and waiting.
I will procrastinate sometimes. If it is a difficult task, I will put it off. While these terms are similar, they have slightly different meanings. So really the purpose here is to clarify the different nuances, the different meanings of these three terms.
So let's jump into our next paragraph. Laziness may be used when someone has a task to perform but isn't completing it because they don't want to use up a lot of their energy.
And that's a good description because our brains are designed to avoid things that use up too much energy. If there's any way to make things easier or shorter, our brain will want to do it.
That's exactly right. In fact, evolutionarily, biologically, we are lazier by design to help preserve energy.
And our brains use up most of the energy in our body. It's something like 40% of everything that happens in your body depends on the brain. So the brain is very, very careful what it devotes its energy to.
Our next sentence, being lazy doesn't mean not doing something at all.
So if you're lazy, that doesn't mean that you are not doing anything.
You can do a job in a lazy way if you are not putting in the effort required to do it well.
What that recalls for me is in boring classes at university, I would take sloppy notes because I didn't think it was that interesting or worth keeping, so I wrote sloppy. But for classes that were really interesting, like human physiology, I look at my notes now, I thought, when did I write that neatly?
Because
it was worthwhile.
Interestingly, this is also the idea I had in my head. In my classroom, I have several students that, as they've gotten older, will begin to write sloppier. And I need to be on them. If you write like this, you will rewrite it. You need to write with at least somewhat legibility. You need to show me that you at least are keeping this within the lines. If I see you, yes, you technically completed the work, but if you do it so poorly that I find it unacceptable, you'll rewrite it. And I need to be on them for that just to keep them honest about what they're doing in my classroom.
Good training.
Let's go to our next sentence here. Of course, you can also be lazy by avoiding the task altogether and instead spending your time watching TV or scrolling on your phone.
This happens a lot, and my students confess to this happening with them when they've got a difficult homework assignment to do.
Yeah. If you're a parent, make sure you do not let your kids take their phone into their bedroom at night. They will never go to bed. I am telling you from experience, they will never, ever go to bed, and that first few periods in the morning will be just torture for those poor kids.
Exactly. Our next paragraph, being lazy might sound like procrastinating, but there is a distinction. So a lot of people think that being lazy and procrastination are the same things. They are not. There is a difference, and they're going to clarify it in this paragraph. Next sentence, when you avoid a job out of laziness, you do so to dodge work. A dodge, D-O-D-G-E, means to run away from so it doesn't hit you. We have a game that's popular in Taiwan, too, which is dodgeball. You're trying to miss being hit by the ball. So when you're lazy, you just want to avoid work altogether. Procrastination usually indicates postponing an unpleasant task by doing other work. So you're not lazy in that you are actually doing work. It's just not the one that's probably more urgent and that's more difficult.
Now, if your Latin is pretty good, this word procrastination is pretty clear because pro just means forward.
For.
And crass is Latin for tomorrow. Mm-hmm. So, hey, we're going to do this tomorrow.
In this case, you're still getting stuff done, just not what you should be doing at that moment. And I am guilty of that sometimes.
I wonder how much I am. Reflecting on it, I'm pretty good at prioritizing. But I mean, when you have a lot of important things and you have a tight deadline, it does become difficult to decide what I need to get done.
What is most urgent?
Right?
If you don't want to write an essay for history class, you may choose to study for a chemistry exam, even though the deadline for the paper is earlier than the date of the test. So one of the things is more pleasant to you and easier, so you do that first. That happens to me.
So a deadline is the date you need to turn it in. If you don't do it by this time, you're going to have some kind of trouble. Another way to say a deadline is your due date, D-U-E space D-A-T-E, due date.
And deadline is not the day you die. This is more about poor time management than being lazy. And in the end, a lot of things come down to time management skills. These should be taught in schools, and they usually are not. I can give you two quick tips that could change your life. Number one is Kaizen, K-A-I-Z-E-N, and it's actually a Chinese word, which I'm not allowed to say on the air now. Kaizen means do a little bit every day, even if it's only a few minutes. Do a little bit every day is number one. Number two is use the Pomodoro technique. That means when you have something to do, set the timer for 25 minutes. Do not check your email. Do not be distracted. Only focus on your work. After 25 minutes, take a five-minute break. Those two things can change your life.
I am a huge proponent of doing a little bit every day. I pound that drum all the time for my students. Like, hey, listen, if you're cramming for 5 hours a night before a test, I'm happy for you. But really, you should have been studying for 1 hour a day for 5 days in advance. You're going to perform better. I am a huge proponent of the a little bit each day method.
Because you actually are able to digest things more. You come up with new interesting problems and questions that you can check the next day. There are many advantages to it.
Now, just to circle back to our second paragraph here, I forgot to say this quote. I just want to stick it in here. So Bill Gates had a really interesting idea about lazy people. And he said, I always find a lazy person to do a difficult job because he will find an easy way to do it. And I am not that person. I am the work harder, not smarter guy. And I have a few friends that are work smarter, not harder. And I admire their ability to do it. I know some people that are just geniuses of cutting corners and still getting it done. That's not me. My boss notices the differences, but I can't argue with the results. And I admire that, although I wouldn't want to be that.
I think the same as you on this, but I understand the sentiment behind it. Sometimes we stick to an old way just out of habit, and we don't stop and think, could I do this in a more efficient way?
That's right. When we cut corners, that means we're kind of cheating a little bit to accomplish a job. And yeah, some of my friends, I really admire their ability to cut corners. Let's go to our next paragraph, our final paragraph. Then there is being idle.
All right. This is the third term that we are going to try to define clearly so we know the differences between laziness, procrastination, and being idle.
So idle, I-D-L-E, means doing nothing, but I-D-O-L, please be careful. This is an image or a statue of a god or a deity to pray to.
Or it could be some big actor or pop singer you're really fond of.
I was thinking of Billy Idol.
Yeah, that's right.
Pop idols, right.
But they are pronounced exactly the same.
Our next sentence, idle means not doing anything, but this isn't always laziness.
And why not, I would like to ask?
Being idle may mean you have done your tasks and are free to do nothing.
So this is a totally different situation, which they will further clarify in the next sentences.
In fact, idleness can be good. The drive to be productive all the time isn't good for us and can leave us burned out.
Now, when I just mentioned the Pomodoro technique, that really did change my life. I did not know about it when I was writing my dissertation. I wish I had. I would sit at the computer and work and work and work for 3-4 hours and end up totally burnt out. So the Pomodoro technique is a good way to avoid burnout, and I use it now to great advantage. So you really do have to watch out for burnout. If you feel burned out, you need a rest.
That's right. So if you're burned out, that generally means you're hardworking. This is probably the opposite of laziness. So a burned out person is a person that has worked hard, but so much that you can't get any more done because maybe you're just your mind and body can't accept it anymore.
And you don't want to risk your health because of this.
That's right. Our next sentence and our final sentence, instead, it is healthy to enjoy moments of idleness when we can give our bodies and brains a rest.
Now, I'm sort of like you in that I think I should always be working. But at some point, my body just makes its own decisions. It ignores the brain who's saying, you got to work some more. My body says, I'm going to take a hike. I'm going to take a shower. I'm going to do something else. And so my body often will tell me, even when my brain is kind of still driving me to do more work, My body will get me to do something that I need to do to kind of be idle for a while and then give my brain some time to recover.
How good are you at doing nothing?
Not good.
Not good. You couldn't just lay on the bed, no phone, no book, no audio, just laying on the bed, looking out the window on a sunny day.
I can do it if I lie down and go to sleep.
Yeah, I think that's...
Because sometimes I really just need sleep. But to just lie there and do nothing is very difficult.
My wife will ask me to be idle like this. I suppose it's... Yes, yes. Oh, no, I agree. And I tell her it's really difficult for me.
No can do.
Right. And what ends up happening is I'll often fall asleep. I'm very bad at not doing anything. And this isn't like we'll have a conversation. It's doing nothing. And my wife can do this and she doesn't mind it. And it's really difficult for me. It's really, really difficult for me to do nothing.
Occasionally, I will just sit down with the iPad and watch some YouTube videos because I feel so burnt out. And sometimes that gives some relief. But often I will just get dressed and go out for a hike, which means I may be also listening to audiobooks or paying attention to nature. So I'm still doing something. And also it's exercise.
Were you ever a lazy person? Was there ever a point in your life where you went through a stretch of laziness? Or were you always what we call a go-getter, G-O-getter? That means a motivated person.
I think back on that sometimes. And what I come up with is even when I was very young, I was learning languages. So if I had free time, I would sit down and work on language learning.
Interesting. So myself, I was a young go-getter. And then around 10th grade, I hit a real heavy patch of laziness. And I ended up failing 10th grade math because of it. Oh. I got a 15 on the final exam.
Oh, wow.
My math teacher picked up the exam and he said, so I'll see you in summer school in 2 weeks, Mr. Gorski. And I my heart sunk. And it was a hard learned lesson because I went from being a top level student. I was the top student in my elementary school, failing math a couple years later. And then just like the fires of hell burned in my heart. And I was like, never again. And
so you recovered really quickly.
It took about a year to really learn how to do it properly.
What do you think brought it on?
Just being a 15-year-old screwball. There's no good answer.
It happens. Okay, I hope that this has been some food for thought for you and that you tune in next time. We'll see you then. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.